so much, Bob. Thank you so much. And thank our good Lord, who is so great and so good and so mighty. I'm glad to see you here today. And I'm glad to see all those who worship with us through our social media. My name's Vicki Landrum, and I'm the pastor here at Centenary. I got a message, a text this week from one of our members who's normally here, and she told me that she had a family gathering this week, but that if she couldn't make it here, she would be worshiping with us online, that she had had to do that 2 weeks ago because she was ill. And so I give thanks to God today for our media ministry. Thanks to Christopher and to Wendy and Cam for all they do to make this ministry available to not only our members, but to our broader community. So thank you so much. If you'll take a moment to sign the registration pads, our friendship tradition of sharing our names with one another and passing that down the pew and back up, that would be a great thing. Helps us to just keep up with each other and also hopefully helps you to get to know people who sit close by you. I have just a couple of announcements I want to share. You'll see in your bulletin many things that are happening here during Lent, and I hope that you will be inviting your friends and family and people you work with to come and be part of some of the special worship services that we have throughout this season. You'll notice that our Stations of the Cross are hung up, and we thank Bonnie Wimberly for painting those. This is a wonderful tradition that's been going on for several years now. And any time that the church is open, you can pick up a guide at the back of the sanctuary and then begin your journey right here and walk with Jesus by pausing in front of each of these pictures. If you bring your Bible, you can read the scripture for that particular station. This is an ancient tradition of walking and journeying with Christ as he goes to the cross, and I'm so glad that this is part of our tradition here at Centenary. Also, you'll see a new offering on the back of your bulletin. I'm so excited that we will be hosting a night of praise and worship for the happening. Our students decided it was just too long between one happening and another, and so they wanted to have a chance to get together in between. And so we're the in-between place to be. And all of us are invited to be present, and you'll see that date of March the 19th at 5:30. And then on one final note, you'll see the page number 5 that has a variety of announcements. We will have our noontime devotional meeting on March the 5th. And we're also going to meet with our grief groups. We've moved to a once-a-month meeting, and so this Tuesday, there's a mistake in this announcement. So this Tuesday at 5:30, we'll meet in the prayer room, and then we'll also meet on Wednesday at noon to renew our friendships and just to catch up on one another as we move forward in this Lenten time. A personal example of why continuing to meet is important. This weekend, my sister hosted and her husband hosted a family reunion for my mom's side of the family. And I think we ended up with 31 people for lunch yesterday. And it's the first gathering of this sort that we've had since Joe, my husband, died. And, you know, you think in this grief journey that you are further along than sometimes you are. And then on top of that, I got a picture of our grave marker that had his name and has my name on it. And just the reality of the finality. So it's been a hard week. And I apologize for my delay in getting here this morning. But when we're dealing with grief, we can't control that. But we can make good choices in how we reach out for help. And our grief support ministry has been that help for many people. So if you have not been to the group and need to come, I hope you'll make plans to be here on Tuesday at 5:30 or Wednesday at noon as we join together. Won't you join me now as we pray? God, we come before you here in the middle of Lent. And the clouds are getting darker as we journey with you closer to the cross. And part of us would like to run and hide. But you continue on and you ask us to journey with you. So be with us today as we encounter you in Scripture, as we sing your praises, as we experience you in a still, small voice, and as we are surrounded by the love and care of Christian friends in this world and in the holy heaven with you. So, Lord, help us breathe and help us to be receptive to what you have in store for us this morning. Amen.
Please stand if you're able to join me in our first hymn, number 159, hymn 159.
Children, join me down front for children's moments. Woo, good morning. such excitement. Yay! All right. Oh, that we were all that excited to come to church. Good morning. How are we today? All good? And I know we're happy to be here, aren't we? Yes, we are. Boys and girls, we continue in the season of Lent, and we remember what Pastor Vicki told us the very first Sunday of Lent. First of all, everything we see, the colors this season, the crosses, they all point to the season of Lent and remind us of something very, very special. That's right. Did you hear that, Pastor Vicki? She said it before I did. When we see purple, pray.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right. And you remember last week we looked up and we saw the altar behind us with all of the crosses up there. We just sang a song, Lift High the Cross, the love of Christ proclaim till all the world knows Jesus' name. The cross is a very important part of Lent. And we do. We lift high the cross so that the world might know the love of Jesus, because he died on that cross for you and for me and for everybody else, for whosoever would believe in him. And so we look to those kind of things during Lent. Now, today, our scripture lesson is taken from the Gospel of John, or our gospel lesson is taken from John. And we're going to hear a story about something Jesus did. And it's going to be kind of shocking because we're not used to seeing Jesus do such things. But he's going to go to his Father's house, which is the church or the temple back in his day. And he's going to do some house cleaning, because there were some things going on in God's house that weren't very godly and that did not honor God. And so, do you know what Jesus did? He went in. He had a whip. And he started slinging this whip and turning things over, turning tables over, letting animals go loose, and turning money tables over. And again, we look at that story and we see what Jesus did long ago to clean up his Father's house. But we have to ask ourselves today, if Jesus came here, what kind of house cleaning would he do? What kind of house cleaning would he do in here, this church? And what kind of house cleaning would he do in our lives? That's what the season of Lent is all about, for Jesus, for us to look to Jesus and his love and know that everything that he does, he wants us to experience a good life. And sometimes that means looking in deep inside our lives and see if there are things there that shouldn't be there, and let Jesus do a little house cleaning in our own lives, and maybe even here in our church, so that we can be the very best church that God has called us to be, and more so that we can be the very best people that God has called us to be, because we're his disciples, aren't we? And we're supposed to show the world all about Jesus. And sometimes there are things in the way that keep us from doing that, but during Lent we ask Jesus to come and clean our houses, which would be our lives, and show us how we can be the best that God wants us to be. So, can we pray about that?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, let's pray about that. Dear God, thank you for these precious children who come with eager hearts, Lord, ready to learn and to hear your word and what you would say to us today. And so, Lord, we ask you to come. We invite you to come into our lives, into our hearts, and into our church, Lord, and show us how we can be the very best. And if there are things that stand in the way of that, that you will help us, Lord, to remove those things from our life, because we want to be what you have called us to be, disciples who love Christ and serve Christ and show the world how good Christ is. In Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen.
How's that for lingering at the altar rail? I'm calling an audible right now, and I'm going to ask Christopher to come and Bob to play as we stand to sing Beneath the Cross of Jesus, number 297, please. Our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our gospel lesson today comes from the second chapter of John, verses 13 through 22. John 2, 13 through 22. John will be the fourth book in the New Testament. Hear now the reading. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And in the temple he found people selling cattle and sheep and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple with the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here and stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to Jesus, "Well, what sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. And after he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Please be seated. As Connie mentioned, as she led our children and the children's moments, this is a picture of Jesus that we do not see very often in Scripture. This picture of Jesus raging mad. I mean, if you grab up a whip and you start running people out of the temple, that's pretty mad. And when we're talking or teaching our children and teaching our youth about how we are to act as Christian people, this is not the first lesson we share with them, is it? And yet, standing up for what is right, being brave when we need to be brave, is part of the Christian walk. I think the trick we have, the difficulty we have in how we use our anger, is to make sure that the ways in which we use our anger are not self-serving. Because sometimes when we're angry, we can just fly off the handle. Anyone know about that? Or we can ride a high horse. You know about that? Or we can think that we have all the right answers and that no one else in the world is correct. So we'll have a sermon in another time that really focuses on how we use our anger. Whether we stuff it, whether we're a person who flies off the handle, whether we're a person who's like a bomb ready to explode at the least thing, we'll talk more about that. But today, we just acknowledge that Jesus is really, really angry. And that he's so angry that he takes this kind of action. He doesn't preach in a soft-spoken way, but he grabs that whip and he moves people and animals and money all over the place. Now, there are all kinds of theories around exactly why this happened. And we will just skim the surface on those, but you can certainly read more about why the animals were there. It was part of the sacrificial system within the Jewish faith. And the animals were there for this big Passover celebration where people were coming in from all places to worship at the temple. The animals were there supposedly for convenience because everyone needed to purchase or bring a certain kind of animal to be sacrificed. One author that I read in preparation for today said that this setup used to be on the next mountain across from the temple, but somehow it had moved into the temple, and you had animals, and you had the money changers, and you had everybody all crowding into the temple. And Jesus saw that not as a way of offering a good service to those who came to worship, but he saw it as an act of greed, that these people, these merchants, had located their business in the temple, and that is not what the temple was intended for. The temple was intended to be a place of worship, not a marketplace. It wasn't the equivalent of a mall in Jesus' day, but rather it was a place of worship. I have a question for you and for me. When do we act as though the sanctuary is just a place of business as opposed to a place of worship of God? I know some people who will join a church because it's the status church in town and it's the best place they can make contacts for their business. And we do meet people and we do make contacts. But when our primary reason for being in a church is for status or to make a connection so that we will profit from them in our business, that substitutes the intent of worship with an action that is really out to just make ourselves better. I served a church one time that was in a transitional community. And we all know that that transitional community means that there was a bunch of white flight and there was a bunch of African American folks moving into the neighborhood. And there just didn't seem to be an interest in having conversations about how we would do ministry together. So when I arrived there, the topic of conversation every Sunday in one Sunday school class was, when are we all going to leave in this Sunday school class, and where are we all going to go together? Because the most important thing is keeping our friend group together. You got me? And so when people would visit, they would hear this conversation about this church that was planning its own funeral. And who wants to go to a funeral? Not me, unless I have to. And so in having those kinds of conversations in that church, it created this sense of a church getting ready to die instead of a church living. And I believe if Jesus had walked in on that, it might have been a whip moment. What do you think? It might have been a whip moment. You and I are to come to worship in order to offer praise to God. It's our work, the work of the people. It's our work to offer praise to God for all God has done for us. Worship is that opportunity also where by reading the word and hearing the songs of our faith sung and having time to quieten our souls that we have this space created, not only a physical space, but space in our heart where God might do God's work in us, so that we might do God's work for God. And when it becomes something different, then we really have to look at what needs to change here. What kind of housekeeping needs to be done here so that we can be the faithful people of God? A question that I have asked in several groups since I've been here for 8 months now, as we think in ahead on what is the ministry of our church, the signature ministry of our church, the one that everyone knows within the walls of the church and knows outside the walls of the church. What will that be? And the question that goes along with that is this one. If we closed our doors tomorrow, would anyone notice? I want to say that again. If the doors of Centenary United Methodist Church closed tomorrow, would anybody in the community notice? And if the answer to that question is no, then it's time for some house cleaning, wouldn't you say? These are the things that bubble up when we encounter this kind of harsh language, this kind of harsh action on the part of Jesus, this kind of action that shakes us up a little bit, because this is not meek and mild. This is instead gritty and serious and necessary. Now, not only does this scripture call us to look at house cleaning within our church, but as Connie mentioned, it also calls us to look at house cleaning within our heart. What are those things within our heart that are barriers to Jesus really being the Lord of our life? Are we okay, you think? Okay. Susan, would you go and check? Thank you. I got to make sure my sheep are all okay. Okay. What about our hearts? Where is there need for some just regular cleaning? And where is there need for deep, deep spring cleaning? The kind of cleaning you do when you're moving out of the parsonage and the new person's coming right behind you. The kind of cleaning that you do when you're trying to make the profit on your house go up higher, where you vacuum the floor and you also dust the baseboards, where you vacuum not only on top of the rug but under the rug, where we do that deep cleaning that allows us to make sure that Jesus is primary in our life. And this season of Lent, part of it is designed for that. So, are we okay? Lent is designed for that we might participate in this spring cleaning. So far in Lent, we have gone into the wilderness with Jesus, and last week we talked about taking up our cross, and this week we're talking about Jesus coming in and cleaning out the crevices of our heart so that we have more space for God. Because if our heart is just full of junk, bad attitudes, past hurts, grudges that we bear, people that we need to forgive, if it's all full of that kind of thing, then it's hard for Jesus to have room to do the work that Jesus is prepared to do for you and for me. I think I would rather have Jesus show up with a vacuum cleaner than a whip. I'd rather Jesus show up with white gloves on to test for dust than a whip. But you know, sometimes we need to be shaken, to hear what Jesus says. And for some of us who were brought up with a very authoritative, authoritarian view of God, it's hard for us to hear Jesus of mercy and grace. And so for those of you who need a little bit of hellfire and brimstone, here we go. This is about as much of that as you'll get from me. And yet it is important to acknowledge that this side of Jesus exists. And that here on this Sunday of Lent, that we are being shaken by the shoulders to say, look up, Vicky, look up, and help me get rid of those things in your heart that are keeping you from following me completely. My prayer as we continue our journey through Lent, and as we prepare to celebrate Easter on the last Sunday of this month, that you and I might use this scripture as a way to meditate on God's word, to let God show us those places, those attitudes, those actions that we need to clean up and clear out so that we might experience Christ in deeper and wider and more meaningful ways this Lent, and that we might be prepared to experience the Easter of resurrection. So what you think? Can we journey together with Jesus to the cross? Will we allow this cleaning of our house, both here in our church and in our heart, to take place fully? There's a song in our hymn book that we'll be singing as our last hymn, but I also want us to sing it right now. It's a prayer about being a sanctuary, and it's in your black hymnal on page 2164. And as Christopher comes to lead us, may this be our prayer song, preparing us for the prayer of confession that you find in your bulletin. Praying confession is a way in which we cleanse our heart. It's a way in which we help Jesus to make us whole. It's a way in which we get rid of the junk so that there is more room for Jesus. Let us sing. Continue our prayer, O Lord, as we together confess our sin. We give you thanks for giving us this kind of prayer that helps to clean out the things that don't need to be in our heart. So, Lord, hear our prayer as we pray together. With hearts of sorrow, we come before you, O God, to confess what you already know. We have failed to keep your laws. Again and again, we have followed our own selfish will rather than your holy and life-giving will for our lives. We have twisted your decrees and institutions to suit our preconceptions and interests rather than your own. Forgive us, O God, and cleanse us from hidden faults, that the words of our mouths and the meditations of all of our hearts may be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Let us pray silently. Jesus teaches that if we confess our sins, that God is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins. So friends, in the name of Jesus Christ, you and I are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
And because we are forgiven, we come boldly with our prayers and concerns this morning. And so, as always, I would ask you to take note of the many names that are listed in our bulletin. We pray faithfully each week, one for another. Some of the needs we are aware of, some we are not. But one thing we can be sure of, God knows each and every need. And so this day we would also add to our prayer list Debbie Festmeyer. Debbie is the wife of Art Festmeyer and sister-in-law of Ike and Laurie. She is in the hospital awaiting surgery. We received a prayer concern the other day, hoping that she would have it immediately. She has not had it, but is in hopes of maybe that happening today or tomorrow. So let's be in prayer for Debbie as she awaits this surgery, and we pray for God's healing hand to touch her. And also for Emma Atkinson, granddaughter of Ashley and Gay, we want to pray for her as she is undergoing tests and to see other doctors this week. And we give thanks that Neil Randall had a procedure this past week and is with us and doing well. So we give thanks to God for answered prayer, and we ask him to continue to be with us and be a real presence in each and every life that we pray for this day and every day. Let us pray. Lord God, again, because we are forgiven people, Lord, we come boldly before your throne of grace, giving thanks for all it is that you have done for us through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. You loved us, and you call us, Lord, to be your people, to be your light in this world. So help us, O God, as we go through this season of Lent, to look in our lives and to see those things that maybe don't honor you, and to cleanse us of those things that you might create in us a new heart, so that we might truly be the light of Christ in this your world. We thank you for the privilege of praying one for another, and we lift these names up before your throne of grace, and we pray for Debbie and Emma and Neil and all the other names listed here today. Lord, and those that may be on our heart that we do not have listed or that we have not called forth, you know each and every need, and we trust you, Lord, to know what's best for each and every one of us. And so we ask you, Lord, to bless as only you can, and to bless within this service as we continue to worship you and love you with all of our hearts, with all of our soul, and with all of our being. And at this time, we lift our voices in prayer to you, praying the prayer that you taught, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers prepare to come forward, we remember that as forgiven and reconciled people, we offer ourselves and our gifts to God. And the beautiful flower offering this day is given to the glory of God and in honor of Stephanie and Zachary Schilling on their wedding last night, in honor of Jeremy Schilling on his birthday, and in honor of Henry and Cindy Schilling for their anniversary.
As we prepare to sing our last song today, which is Sanctuary, I want to make sure that those who visit know that I'll be down front. Those who are here regularly know that I'm normally down here. And if there's anything you want to say or introduce yourself or ask me a question, I'll be right here. And if there is a faith commitment that you're ready to make, I'd love to talk to you about that. And as always, the altar rail is open for prayer. You know, where you and I are standing is a sacred space because God is with us. And what commitment may you and I make this week to Jesus Christ to walk this path to Lent? And as we sing this last song, may we lift that commitment to God as we join our voices in sanctuary. Are taking the light of Christ out before us. We're not alone out there, but rather the light of Christ leads us and guides us. So go forth from this place knowing that you are loved by Jesus Christ. Go forth from this place to share that love with all you see. Go forth in strength and in wisdom and in power and in love and mercy. Amen. Amen.